couple things about me real quick. I have to apologize. My voice is a little off. My thinking is a little off. I either am allergic to Bangalore or I got a cold the second I arrived that feels a lot like being allergic to Bangalore. So I've been trying to recover from that for the last couple days. So bear with me. So second, Amit mentioned something important, which is, so I'm a proud full-time JavaScript hacker. That's all I've done for pretty much the last 4 years. And the one piece of context that I think is important just to understand where I'm coming from, and I think a lot of us are coming from someplace similar, is I do a lot of work with Angular. We've been using Angular very heavily at MDL since it was released, since 1.0. In particular because it's great for rapid prototyping. You can get a lot done very, very quickly. So the world is moving on. I don't think people are moving away from Angular, but we've got all kinds of new stuff. And so my investigations with React and starting to deploy it over the last few months come from that perspective. I'm still sort of transitioning, and I think a lot of other people are, so I hope that that's useful. I hope I can translate a little bit. All right, and then the other thing I have to apologize for a little bit is that I have the slot right after lunch. Nobody wants the slot right after lunch. Everybody's energy levels are up for like the first 10 minutes because they've got a blood sugar rush going on, and then it crashes, right? So we're going to try to keep the energy level up. I'll try to not go crazy too often. But if I do see anybody totally nodding off in the back, I'm gonna let rip with "Aj kuktu fani karti hen." I've been hanging out with Salman Khan way too much. He just keeps saying that over and over and over and over. But so if I see somebody nodding off because of the post-lunch coma, I'm gonna hit you with that. All right. Let's do a quick survey. How many folks in here spend most of their time writing JavaScript? Cool. How many folks, what we'd call single-page applications or mobile applications built principally out of JavaScript? Okay. How many folks have used React in production as yet? Okay, you guys can leave. We're going to be starting from scratch, so everybody else is in good shape. The rest of you guys, I hope that there's some valuable perspective here. But I just want to set everybody's expectations that we are going to start with the most basic React component, work our way up from there, and by the end have a full Flux pattern application going. And we're going to focus along the way on some big ideas. The premise for me, coming from having spent so long with Angular and a little bit of Ember, and now moving towards React and seeing where Angular is going, and Aurelia and everything else that's happening, it seems like almost another paradigm shift already. And so React in particular embodies kind of all in one place in its really fundamental approach a lot of the new big ideas that are coming down the road at us. So just a few years after we sort of all began shifting towards single-page applications and JavaScript applications, we're already looking at some fairly fundamental shifts in how we do that. So the plan is a little bit of intro, a lot of code. I hope that works for everybody. So we'll do an intro to concepts, then we'll do demos with just React, just looking at React by itself, then follow up with like some summary about that. And then, because this thing is 2.5 hours, I think, we're going to take a break in the middle, a little leg stretch. Then same thing again, but with Flux. So a few slides just to set the scene, and then we get to code. And again, these repos, so we're not live coding this thing. That just wouldn't work. And in fact, my demo wound up being probably 50% more complex than it needed to be. But you can step by step through the repo, commit by commit, and follow along with what we're doing. If you really want to, you can do that here today in the audience. We just won't be able to sort of stop and problem solve with you. Even better, hopefully, it's a takeaway. It's something that you can take home and get some value out of, even after the session is over. Just questions. I'll be very happy to take questions. The only thing I think all conference attendees and hosts can agree on is that the best kind of questions are ones that are really trying to clarify something that just hasn't been said well, that hasn't been detailed enough, and not what I call Jeopardy questions. Do you guys have the game show Jeopardy here? Do you know that? So the basic premise is that you get the you get an answer to a question, and then so who says "Aaj kuch tufani karti hai" on TV, and then instead of saying Salman Khan, you're supposed to say who is Salman Khan. That's the catch of Jeopardy. So a Jeopardy question is a question that isn't really a question. You already know the answer, but you're phrasing it like a question. And so instead of saying that's a really dumb idea, you say, well, don't you think in the context of Aurelia and Angular and all these other things, that's a really dumb idea? You already know where you're going with that. You can write a blog post about that. And the reason is, the only reason I say it is because it takes time from the audience. Definitely hit me with anything that's unclear. Please ask questions. Otherwise, we can talk offline afterwards. So why are we here? What is this? This looks a lot like the Chinese stock market over the last 9 months or so. This is the Google Trends. Everybody starts with these. It doesn't prove anything. The fact that people on Google are really interested in React now doesn't prove anything about how good it is or whether it's better than anything else. It does prove that it's got staying power. Right? It came out back in 2013, and we were all like, oh, it's kind of a clever thing. People are talking, it's Facebook, that's interesting. And I myself, I for a while wrote it off as React only makes sense when you have 200 developers working on the same code base. That's a great way to solve that problem. But it has borne the test of time, and people just keep adopting it and adopting it and adopting it. Incidentally, it looks like another adoption curve, which is Angular's, which is not to say Angular is the bomb, although it certainly does seem to be the big framework, particularly in this region. But it has staying power. So this was the same period of time, basically, in the development of Angular. And this near parabolic interest curve, I think, indicates that React is here to stay. It's going to be around for a while. And also, it's backed by this little internet startup you might have heard of. And they seem to have, oh, hello, JSChannel. Let's cancel that. They seem to have something to do with the interest level in React as well. All right, so here's what we're looking out for today. Components, 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 components. The whole world, I think, is moving more and more towards the idea that anything in an interface should be componentized. It should stand alone to the greatest extent possible. So the traditional MVP pattern doesn't really do this. You've got all kinds of concerns all mingled together in one controller and one view. Everybody's going this way. Angular 2 is going this way. Angular 1 already had directives. Angular 2 is making it explicit. Ember has had the Ember component pattern from day one, I think. And that's what React, in particular, the library React, is all about, view components. And we want them to be dumb. We want them to be, to really just know what they have to do. Show something, take some input on that. That's it. Get the logic for everything else that you're doing out of there and decouple it. Decouple not only the components from the system, but when we look at the Flux pattern later, it's all about decoupling the different parts of the system from each other. what the fancy term location transparent messaging, that basically just means actions and events that where you have as few assumptions as possible. So for instance, the Angular dispatcher pattern, the premise is that you just, everybody gets every event. You're either listening or you're not listening. And what that means is that nobody involved knows anything about what's happening at the other end of the pipe. And that's a really powerful pattern. The world of React, it's not kind of baked in. It's not a mandatory part of it. But the world of React and the world of Node seem quite close. The more reading you do, the more looking at examples, both at Facebook and elsewhere, you see that these patterns seem to have merged. And there are tools for doing things other ways that don't involve Node. You can still do lots of React with Bower. But this is a trend. I think we'll see it. I think we'll see Node leaking into the browser more and more and more. And I think that's worth checking out. A lot of Node is about the Unix philosophy, about small, sometimes even just single line, little pieces of code. And that philosophy of Node, that philosophy of Unix, informs what we're trying to do with our components. It informs what we're trying to do with Flux, and with where, ideally, our craft is going in the future. And of course, since we're doing Node, a lot of the time you see lots of modules and explicit dependency injection. Again, you don't have to use those, but I think it's a best practice. We're also moving towards everything in JavaScript. This is an interesting trend. You'll see within 10 seconds with React, you're like, where's the templates? Where's the HTML? It's not there really anymore. And so people have been taking the logical next step and actually even beginning to move all of their CSS into JavaScript. Again, there's nothing necessary about that, but it seems to be the direction that we're moving. Virtual DOM is the big buzzword. It's in all the market speak. But it's really about something else. Virtual DOM is really something that's hidden from you. You don't really interact with it. You don't do anything with it. What we hear is that it makes our applications faster, that they render faster. What's really important about that, the existence of that virtual DOM allows us to create our whole application structure without needing a DOM, right? So your app lives entirely independent of what's happening in the actual browser or in the DOM context specifically. And doing that makes it easier for us to get to model things the way we want them to move our data through JavaScript in a one-way flow, and to move our rendering in a one-way flow. You only go in one direction. You render stuff down the tree, then when you need to replace it, you just replace it. You don't update it. And then there's this interesting, this is from a talk, a paper that Angular published as part of the Angular 2 investigations. They called it Being DOM versus Rendering DOM. And we're going to see this in our examples. The question is, do you start with the DOM? Okay, so do you start with a HTML template on which you declared some Angular directives or something like that, and then use those as anchors to go out and grab some JavaScript and attach that JavaScript to something that's already in the DOM? Or do you start with an application that exists entirely in JavaScript and use that to render the DOM? These are very different approaches. Now, arguably, it doesn't necessarily on a given day change your life whether you're using tools that emphasize the DOM to JavaScript model or the JavaScript to DOM model. It's the kind of thing that starts being clear over the long term once you realize that all these dependencies are going away, that all of these, wait, did I remember to update that too? Did my Angular watches fire so that when I updated that data someplace else, it actually got noticed by Angular so that the view updated as well. Keeping everything in JavaScript land and then migrating from there to the DOM makes these relationships a lot clearer. And then the other thing that we're doing differently is instead of dollar watch, which is an Angular construct, or even we're moving towards observables, but the question is, do you watch things and then fire updates on that basis. So keep the DOM where it is and just go find this piece and change it, and go find this piece and change it, and go find this piece and change it. Or do you just re-render it? Do you just re-render the whole thing? And I just threw this in. This is a great, Sindre Sorhus has written something like 500 or 600 node modules. This was just a little post he did recently, but it basically just talks about that Unix philosophy and why the Unix philosophy is relevant to us, is relevant in the browser, is relevant everywhere. Just go look at that. I'm sorry? Sindre, S-I-N-D-R-E, Sorhus, S-O-R-H-U-S. And if you need the, if you can't find it, it's kind of buried, actually. If you can't find it, hit me up later. So what is React? React is a library, not a framework. It just doesn't have the characteristics of a framework. It's just for rendering. That's it. So if you start from MVC, React is just the V. It's the view layer. That's it. I think that MVP, we're kind of moving on. MVC. We're moving on from MVC. So React just makes components, and then it composes those components together into larger and larger and larger interfaces. But really, most of the time, in most models that you see, there's one master component that runs everything. And you're going to see in a second how bare that leaves your HTML file. It's not a tiny library, but it has a rather small API. It only does a couple things. It's not for building whole apps. And because of that, because they're trying to reduce their surface area and just do things that are critical, we do basic JavaScript in most things. You'll find yourself saying, well, how do I do X in React? How do you do it in JavaScript? That's probably how you do it in React. The browser support situation is good. React just relies heavily on the ES5 JavaScript features, but if you just shim those, you're in good shape. So your whole interface is a tree. And as we talked about before, when the question is it DOM to JavaScript or JavaScript to DOM, are you saying that the DOM tree mirrors the JavaScript tree or vice versa? And in the case of React, the DOM tree is downstream of the tree that React uses to model your whole application. So for every DOM element, there's actually a component. This idea that it's only JavaScript, we're going to see that in the examples that we do here today. It's not. There are people who are creating tools for sort of importing HTML templates into React. It does seem to be out of the mainstream at this point in time. That doesn't mean it's bad. That doesn't mean don't do it. If it helps you get work done, then it's a good thing. But it doesn't seem to be where we're going. And so data flows in one direction down the tree. Rendering flows in one direction down the tree. This word unidirectional, it comes up over and over again. And so we never update the DOM. We never mutate the DOM. We simply re-render it. And so eventually, somebody who knows React already knows that, well, actually, in the background, React does sometimes do things that you could describe more as mutating rather than chopping off the whole DOM fragment and sticking in a new one. But that's abstracted from you. It's hidden from you. As far as you're concerned, what you get to think about is, I don't have to figure out how to go back and update all these things. I'm just going to start over. Everything that I did before, forget about that. I'm just going to do it again. Only this time different. So let's see one. Code. All right. And so we're going to be using, this is source tree. Oh, wait, we need to mirror. Okay. This is source tree. I'm a big fan of it for managing your Git repositories. So very simple. What do we have here? Let's make this even smaller because this screen is really compact. And I don't think I can even change the resolution of that other one. Wait, let's try. Yes, much better. Okay. We're starting with the simplest possible example. There's no automation here. There's nothing else going on in this repository. We have a single HTML file. We've got the React library, and we've got the JSX transformer library. JSX is this syntax that we use to create, to model our components in React. And we're going to talk more about that in a bit. But for now, the thing to know is just that you have to transpile. You have to convert JSX to JavaScript before you can use it. What we're doing here is we're doing that in the browser. Most of the time, you want to do that before you deploy, and we'll see an example of that. And then all we've got, our whole body has a single div in it, which is just an example. Now, that may seem like, oh, well, that's just for the demo, right? That's crazy. But that's actually how not all, but many, most React applications work, is that the only thing you've got in your index.html is just one element, and the whole React infrastructure hangs off of that one element. And then this is where the magic happens. Right now, we're simply just calling the React render method. And we're telling React to create a new element called an H1. Okay, so React knows what all the default HTML elements are. Even though our goal long term is to create these custom components with React, React also knows how to build basic DOM elements. And then we're going to populate it with some text. And actually, am I all the way back? Yep. And then we're going to attach it, so right here after the comma, we're telling it which element to grab it with, right? So you could do that with jQuery. You could say, find this element and then attach something to it. In this case, we try to skip jQuery when we can because React really doesn't need it. And what that gets us, whoops, get rid of that. We didn't play any intro music after all. Whoops. If for those of you who follow along in the repo, there are README files and to-do files that clarify what we need at most points in time to actually run this repo. In this case, I think all we need is just a simple server. So we're just going to start httpster. Oh. Yeah, that's right. That won't work. So, sorry guys, localhost 3333. There we go. Hello world. And so React is rendering into the DOM this little code. So it's just a tiny little thing, and but that's the basics of what a React element looks like. But that's a toy example. So let's move forward. And the first thing we're going to do is actually we're going to get rid of the JSX transformer. We really don't want to be transforming JSX in the browser. We want to do that with our automation tools. How many of us are already using Grunt, Gulp, Broccoli, something like that in development? Webpack, anything like that? Most people, it seems like. It really is critical here because just to get from the code you're writing with React to what you can execute in the browser, you have to do this transpilation step. So you need something when you're working, and so you'll want to adopt one of those workflows right now. And all that is the offline build simply happens. We are installing this tool called React Tools. And then we're going to run React, or the JSX tool, to compile our JavaScript for us. And so now that that's running, we have a server running. That's really all it takes to proceed on with this stuff. And okay, and if we jump back, yeah, we just changed the S to a Z. Hello worlds, very sexy, very chic. All right, next step, we want a real example. That example that we did before, we just went straight to make an H1 for me. We didn't actually build a component before we asked React to render it. In this case, so we don't have any new to-dos this time. So here is our hello world still. And then here is this new component called hello message. Now, hello message is a more traditional React component. This is what you should do. And the critical thing is we're doing React create class. And then what we supply to it, the one critical thing that you can't have a React component without is the render method. The render method simply says, all right, so we've got this object, okay, I've got this tree of React objects. I wanna do something with it. I wanna put it in the DOM. How do I do that? The render method tells you how to put it in the DOM. And so we're simply saying, okay, give me a div, put some text in it. And then there's this thing here, this called props. So React passes data through the application. We're gonna look at the model for this more later. But we have props and we have state. We're gonna say repeatedly and clarify more, state is mutable, props are immutable, right? Props are something that we're just gonna render it and then it's gonna stay the same until we re-render. So in this case, we know that we wanna stick someone's name in, and that name is down here, okay? So we created up here a component called hello message. And then what you say down here to react.render is, it looks like you're creating an element, right? This is an XML style syntax. We're saying render the component called hello message. And we do it in JSX by just putting it in there like that. And then we're adding a prop, okay? And it's just an attribute. You know, whatever we're used to doing with attributes in HTML or XML, you do the same thing to create props and to hand data down. And we're just saying, put that on our container. And so when we go back, now we've got two things. Now we've got this one super simple element, the H1. And then we've got a more traditional one, the hello message, which we've defined by name and then injected. Now we're going to do something more complex. We're going to switch back to, this is the traditional React tutorial. And so our to-do here, don't save, close. All right, so we have to kill that, kill the JSX watcher, run the installer, and then we just do node server.js, which is really a much more sustainable approach to development here. So localhost 3000. All right, and there's nothing there yet. And what we've got we're going to stay simple for now, and we're going to use Reactify later. Okay, and what we almost always start doing here is we start with, we've got our index.html, okay, we have an ID called content, and then we're importing our tutorial. Our tutorial file is here. So we're gonna start, you always start with something, it's often just called app, your root React component. React or app, main, something like that. In our case, we're gonna make a little tiny comment application. So we call it comment box. And for now, just so that we can see that it's working, that it's compiling properly, it just does that. And that's it. You know, you start your React applications with your base element and work out from there. Comment box. Yep. Next, we add some more components. So how do you do that? How do you nest one component within another? Well, it's pretty straightforward. This is JSX. And this allows us to mingle kind of the same way we would with Angular, where we would define a directive that we wanted to use as an element and then just invoke it in our HTML. We can mix together our fundamental HTML components, elements, like divs and h1s, with comment lists and comment form, which are the things we just created. And what we're saying ultimately, when we start back out here, okay, we are down at the bottom. At the very base, we're rendering React comment box, okay? Then inside the definition of comment box, we have these children, or ONEs, as the is kind of the React jargon. And those are defined here. Those are just also React classes, React components. Okay, so everything, anything that has any significance in it, you're going to want to separate into a React component. You know, here we have just an outer wrapper div. We have an H1. Those don't do anything. Those don't have any logic. They're purely presentational. You can have a million of those all in one component. But once you start doing anything, like listing your comments or having a form for comments, you want to break it down, decompose it. And that's what we get. The next thing we do is pass in some props. So before, where we where all we did was pass in just one person's name, what we're saying here is that ideally, whenever humanly possible, our components don't have to think about getting data. Okay, they're not in that business. Only a few special React components have to worry about getting data. The rest of them, we just pass it to them as properties. And so what we're doing, so here, so we start with our comment box, which has our comment list and then a comment form. And the comment list we've now fleshed out a little bit here. We have sub components now called comments. So in the comment box, there's a comment list. In the comment list, there are comments. And what we're doing is passing in a prop here called author. And then another one, this is a sneaky one. This, we call that a child text node, right? So whenever you have a P and then inside of that P you have some text, technically that text is a child text node. And so we're doing that here, and the reason I mention that is not to be pedantic, although I run the risk of that sometimes. It's because that's how React thinks about it. React is going to take that text that's inside there and turn it into a subnode, into a component. And the reason that's significant here is because inside, inside our comment element. So first we're grabbing off of the properties this.props.author, which we declared here. And then we're grabbing this.props.children. Okay, and that text that's inside is a child node. This is a convention that you don't want to use real often. It's probably easier to hand it in another way, but you want to understand it. You want to understand that React is doing that. And so the bottom line is that that gets you the name and then the this is one comment. Let's make that bigger. So far we're just composing. We're starting out big with our root level element, getting smaller. And the other really critical thing we have to do is we have to get data in there. Now traditionally in an MVC pattern, we would just have a controller, right? This big monolithic thing that would have a bunch of elements, an element for the outer box, an element for the inner, for the list itself, and then elements for each of the comments. But all the logic for all of them would be mingled together, which is great at first, until months and months and months later, you want to make small changes. And what you have to do to make a small change to one thing is understand how the whole thing works. You have to understand how the whole controller works, where the controller is getting its data from, in order to understand what's happening with this one component. Here, this comment, I can know everything that I need to know about this comment, about where its data comes from, by just looking at this comment. That's it. That's literally all I need to know. I know that somewhere, when this element is invoked, they're going to be handing me a prop called author. That's it. And then all I have to do is find the place in the comment list where they hand me the prop called author. Now this component is entirely self-contained. You can change it, replace it, swap it in without having to understand anything more complex than these very few lines of code. And this, of course, is why an organization like Facebook loves it. They have literally hundreds of people working on the same relatively small, discrete application, you know, to render something like a list of Facebook activity. And they want each one of those hundreds of developers to be able to focus on one discrete, specific thing, make the changes to that specific thing, commit them, and not have it affect anything else. So if you're a solo developer, the value of that doesn't pile up as quickly for you, but it does pile up over time. Here's an example of how to add some additional stuff, how to use additional libraries. We want to do markdown. We want to take in template strings and turn them into HTML. Now, we've already got that stuff in our, we're calling this function called marked, which is already linked in our JavaScript, in our HTML here, lib marked. Only, and we have invoked it because we've got some, where is our markdown? props.children to string. Yeah, it's all in there. Well, we have markdown in here somewhere, darn it. And it's not rendering. And the reason that it's not rendering is something that, again, we hopefully don't run into too often. But React is very concerned, as Angular and other libraries and frameworks are, about safety of strings, because you can inject other code in when a string is read. So what you have to do to get around that is add this it's in the comments. So all these comments here, which are now hard to read because they're so small, we do dangerously set inner HTML. This is one of the very few things that comes, you know, the few additional utilities that comes with React, is this ability to say, yeah, I know that template strings are risky, but that's okay, let me do it this time. And once we do that, now things render, now we have italics, and we have P's and stuff like that. Again, this goes to the question of whether we are trying to get rid of, not trying to, but rather the industry is moving towards getting rid of templates as strings of HTML and moving instead towards all JavaScript, or if we're going to keep doing what we're used to doing. You can do what you're used to doing. Just know that React is set up. It's going to make you jump through some extra hoops to do it. A markdown parser. That's all it is. It's just a standalone markdown parser. React doesn't have anything like that built in, and you wouldn't want it to. Like, it's a separate concern. We want to pipe that module into our app. Yes. Mm-hmm. Okay, I think the question is specifically, that we're all used to separating our concerns, right? We keep our HTML in one file, we keep our JavaScript in another file. Also, we went through the whole phase of unobtrusive JavaScript, right? That we should just be using jQuery to go find some element and then attach JavaScript to it rather than sprinkling our JavaScript inside of it. And so what is the philosophy, I think you were saying, that we are getting away from that? Fundamentally, I don't think there's anything about this approach that says HTML is bad, HTML should go away. But we're doing two critical things. One, we're starting from our virtual DOM, from our representation of the entire application in JavaScript. Since that is our starting point now, instead of HTML to which we attach JavaScript, that's kind of step one. That's part of what makes us start thinking, oh, well, maybe we could keep everything else in JavaScript as well. Certainly for performance, not needing to go find a little HTML fragment and import it as a separate file each time over and over again, you're definitely going to get better results out of that. Even with Angular, actually when we send stuff to production or other frameworks, we often pre-compile all of our HTML into JavaScript, right? Because it's much more efficient to just pull that straight in. But the other reason, the reason that we hypothetically don't need to have our templates over here and our JavaScript over here and have them be separate concerns, is because now these React components are so atomic. They're so small and so discrete. You know, the comment list, even though this is a component that's going to have a whole bunch of other stuff rendered inside of it, the whole thing fits into 10 lines of code. We've got our template, right? What are our DOM elements going to be? We've got our logic, although there's really no fancy logic here for it yet, all together in one place, in one file. So we are still separating our concerns, we're just not doing it the same way that we're used to. Now, part of the reason that we would keep our HTML and our JavaScript separate the way we do is because it's easier to manage in some ways, but there is also an asymmetry, right? You didn't have one JavaScript file for every piece of HTML or for each template. In this case, though, there's just the component. There's one JavaScript, one template, if you will, one JSX, one set of elements that are going to be rendered. And so it's a match. It's a direct one-to-one match. And so storing them together in one file, I think seems to work. I'm not tripping over things the way I might have expected to. Yeah. To import a template. Yeah, he's saying that it's certainly possible that you could import templates, have a layer of abstraction for that. It's absolutely possible. There are tools for it, so it's absolutely doable. The one thing I would say is try this out first and see if, after you've built a couple things with it and seen it scale a little bit, if you still feel the need to maintain your template separately. There are going to be circumstances where, with certain things, for instance, Markdown. That's why Markdown is in here as an example. Let's say you're rendering a wiki, right? And you're going to grab a whole bunch of stuff and inject it. That's a great use of separate templates, of separate data, right? But once things start getting atomic, you don't really want to keep two lines of HTML in a separate file. There's sort of no point because... And that's what React does to us. It really gets everything quite compact. Yes, and in general, so when we get to our Flux example, we're going to do all that stuff. You're going to see how it's generally modeled out. And in React land, people tend to do that with Browserify, and they import common JS modules. And so each individual component will almost always be a common JS module. No. In fact, the basic premise is that almost nothing is in the global namespace. There are other frameworks that do this as well, but so for instance, with an Angular app that you manage with Bower, where you get your subsidiary dependencies, jQuery, your charting library, whatever else you have going on. When you manage that with Bower, those are in the global namespace. The model that you see most often with React is that each and every individual React component is not in global namespace, and neither are jQuery, high charts, whatever else you have going on. That's all part of basically whichever module loader pattern you're using. But you'll see, we'll see examples of that. We won't go way into the how it works, but you'll see, I think, an example of how you reveal a module, how you expose it, and then how you import it and make use of it. And again, people do this with ES6 modules, they do it with AMD, and they do it with CommonJS, but CommonJS just seems to be the most common. Real quick, so let's finish up our React examples here. We're going to just, all we're doing, we didn't change anything significant. Now we've simply moved our data into a real data source, not just declaring it inline on our elements. I think that was supposed to be Jordan Walker. And what you can see is that, let's just glance at this. Comment list, comment data. Yeah, so here's where we start to, we actually are starting way down here on comment box. This is where we see how data flows down the tree of React elements. So starting with the comment box, we are adding the comment data to comment box, the owner element, the outer one. And so we hand it in. We've created this comment data up here at the top of the file. Down at the bottom, we have our comment box. We're handing it in. And that then goes, so inside of comment box, we have our comment list. And then what we're doing is we're passing the data down to the comment list. And we're saying, hey, this .props.comment data, this belongs to you as well. And then in the comment list, we can reference this .props.comment data and actually do something with it. Now what that means is that you repeat the passing of data down from component to component. This is a little bit of extra typing. This is a few more keystrokes than if all of these components live together in one big controller and you could simply reference whatever you wanted whenever and wherever you wanted it. But again, it's all about the separation of concerns and about knowing that at each and every level of the tree, here's how data gets into this component, here's how data gets back out of this component, and there's really no questions. There's nothing you can't see in 10 or 15 lines of code. The way that we're making use of this, we're now rendering these two comments with kind of a collection view or an ng repeat. And this is one of the most common conventions that you're going to see. Oh yeah, here's our comment list. And instead of having a React tool that allows you to, you know, create a list of items, we just use basic JavaScript. We're just using array.map, built-in function in JavaScript from, I think, ES5 onwards. And we're saying map onto the array of comments the creation of a new node for each one. And then, so that's the comment nodes. So we're mapping the comment data onto this creation function, which will create a comment component for each one. And then we're saying down here, very simple, we don't say ng repeat comment in comment nodes or something like that. We just say, yeah, put the comment nodes here. The reason you can do that is because comment nodes is itself just an array. It's just JavaScript. It's a JavaScript array containing JavaScript objects, which are React components. And React knows, okay, when I get an array of React components, I'm gonna render them. I'm gonna spit them out. And so this has other implications for things like sorting, right? You have this really. The syntax gets very long when you're setting up an ng repeat and you want to sort it, right? We just sort in JavaScript. We do it right here inside the component and do it with our data first and then render it out. All right, we're almost done with this. The one thing we're doing on this example, this is an important thing. In general, with our fundamental components keep hopping around in this file, my apologies for that. We use this critical method called getInitialState. GetInitialState, in general, when you start with your root level, you don't hand in all the data just in JavaScript generally. Somewhere you have components that are responsible for retrieving their own data from somewhere else in the application. And you do that using this critical method called getInitialState. And so what we're saying is we're going to get the set up a comment array and then use it to populate everything else that's going on here. And so we pass it down. By putting it on the state of comment box, we can then pass it down into the comment list. And when we begin updating it in the next example with live data, what we now have is a dynamic process of retrieving data. Okay, now we have more comments. We're retrieving data from this JSON file. Author. I'm not going to spell it. Aj, Cook, Tufani, Karti, Hain. There we go. What's that? Is an extra colon? Where do I have an extra colon? Oh, right. I did. Yes, thank you. Comma, thank you. See, this is why we don't do live coding. And there it is. It picks it right up. Because what we set up in the component was a there's a timer here somewhere. We just have a timeout inside one of our components, and that timeout, this interval here, is periodically just running a function called this.loadCommentsFromServer. And what it is doing, the critical thing, is it's doing this.setState. Okay, set state is critical to understanding how these components work. So we've got our comment box here. We did our get initial state, and we populated it with an empty comment data array. What this function down here is doing is it's setting that state. It's now populating it with our data. So each time, we've talked here about how React doesn't mutate the DOM. It doesn't update the DOM. It simply replaces it. And so whenever you do set state, you're going to trigger a re-render. So this method here, the render method, is going to run all over again. Okay, so now we have the full React lifecycle here. We're setting up some components. One of those components, the top level one, is reaching out, getting some data, pulling in that data, using it to set state. Set state immediately triggers a re-render. And now that data flows down into the children, who are all themselves re-rendered, because they're below the top-level component on the tree. And the interesting thing about this, you'll see this very common, this very frequently. When we do our getInitialState, we're setting up an empty array here. There is nothing in it. Now, this normally sets off problems of, oh, well, gosh, when I update that array later, how am I going to ensure that it, you know, populates, that it gets back down into my views. React takes care of that. That all disappears. That asynchronicity between data updates and the view goes away because a fresh component's going to be rendered using the fresh data, and it's just going to go all the way down the tree until it runs out of components to re-render. And I think, let's see, it's almost 2 already. We're going to see more about this individual React stuff going on later into the other demo. So let's jump back into Keynote for a second. So components. Components are React class instances. They're not really object-oriented, though. This is something, there's a very smart man, he's not sitting at his table anymore. There's a very smart man in attendance who some of you have heard of. He reminded us to go with the grain and use functional patterns whenever possible. At the moment, React Create class is a functional constructor, not a pseudo-classical constructor. Our components have these lifecycle methods. We saw set state and render are kind of the most fundamental of them. But then there are these others that we're going to see later on, so that you can attach handlers, for instance. And those happen after the component has mounted. We have props and state. That's our data. That's how we get our data down through the tree. JSX is how we compose the view. We're going to learn more about that in a second. And we can both, on a React component, we can both add our own methods and we can extend the existing ones. React does something clever where it has this fundamental thing called didComponentMount, or no, I'm getting the name wrong, but all of those internal lifecycle methods. If you add your own, it's going to run both of them. It's going to run both the super method and the additional one that you're adding. And so you can actually add multiple versions of it, and it's just going to run them all in a sequence. So mix-ins are, because we're doing a lot of kind of slightly object-oriented stuff, even though it's functional in nature, we want to be able to reuse code. So mix-ins are reusable methods that we often use for kind of glue functions. And the problem with that is it's a great idea. You can just apply a mix-in to a given component or to a whole bunch of different components and get a lot of functionality right away without having to retype it each time. The problem is that they're going away in ECMAScript 6. So if you go home today and you start reading the React docs, you're going to see all these mentions of mix-ins. And you're going to think, ah, OK, mix-ins, that's how I do React. In the rather near future, unfortunately, they're going to go away. And they also have flaws, which is that you have to sequence them properly. And that's a leaky abstraction. So higher order components, this is where we go back to functional patterns. We use functions to compose new functions. We use a generator function that will take an existing React component, augment it with some new methods, and then spit out the new augmented component as the return. And that's what we're going to see going forward. So mix-ins, still useful right now, but when you move to ES6, in the not too distant future, we'll have to adapt. So rules on props and state. People always ask this, wait, I don't get the state and props thing. Days from now, weeks from now, you're still going to be like, what should be state? What should be a props? I know that it's all data, passing down through my tree of React components. And it's not about the kind of data. Some people will say, well, really, props are for stateful stuff, but state is for the really data stuff. And you're like, no. It's really about where it lives, where it came from, and where it's going. It is state in the place where you can modify it. So in our case, in the comment box, right, that was the outer element, that's the only place where you can retrieve and update that data. That's where it is state. Everyone downstream of that who is consuming it is receiving it as a property. For them, it's immutable, it's unchangeable, it's untouchable. That's the difference. You'll see various versions of this distinction, but that's what it boils down to. And then the best practice is just don't retrieve the same data in multiple places in the same tree, in the same hierarchy, otherwise things get wonky fast. Now we say, okay, everybody makes a big deal about one-way data flow. Data only goes down, it never comes back up. Changes only go down, they never come back up. That's mostly true. But sometimes when you've got a child down at the bottom of the tree that has a button or a form input or something like that, you want to be able to do something with that data. You want to be able to send it somewhere. So often we'll make that outer comment box component the custodian of all state, of all data changes. And we do, in a way, pass data back up to that element, but we do it with simply a callback. We pass down a function to the child, and so the child isn't really executing the logic that does it. It's the owner element. It's that top-level element that is doing it. And that allows the owner element, the top, the comment box instead of the individual comment, to be the logical clear maintainer of the state, the only place where you can update data. So JSX, everything in React is JavaScript. It doesn't have to be. We can import HTML templates if you want, but by default, they're going for everything to be JavaScript. So JSX looks a little bit like HTML. It is not HTML. It doesn't behave like HTML. It's simply a syntax that kind of resembles HTML, and it's actually closer to XML or XHTML. So JSX bridges us. It gets us something that's more visual, that we like better. It transpiles. This is what JSX compiles to. It is kind of like the callback tree from hell on some huge asynchronous callback, 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 callback. Everything gets nested. And so what we've got here is elements within elements within elements, or objects within objects within objects. And technically, these are function calls that return objects. And we wind up nesting these in a way that's completely unreadable. If you really want to, you can write this yourself. You can go straight to this JavaScript. But nobody really wants you to, and even the React team don't recommend it. So this is much more readable. We're much clearer about the hierarchy, about what wraps what. You can see in green this div. We close it at the end. We're used to that. We're used to HTML. And it makes it a little bit easier when we jump into our browser and start debugging. We can more easily match up what's going on in our JSX with what's going on in our HTML. These are just specific things that you'll learn, but what's important here? Think of your components as classes, so name them. JavaScript convention, other languages convention, a class name always starts with a capital letter. Whereas the traditional HTML elements, technically inside React, those are classes as well. But for convention's sake and to make it clear what's custom and what's not, you lowercase those. We camel case our attributes. You really want to avoid doing hyphenated or snake case attributes. Again, that's because this is JavaScript. We're trying to use JavaScript conventions, and also because this is getting transpiled. So you have to stick very narrowly to the JSX syntax. And you can see you can't even use the word class anymore because, of course, class is a reserved JavaScript keyword. So you have to use the word class name, the attribute class name instead. And we even have to wrap our comments. So a standard traditional JavaScript comment we wrap in curly braces so that it can be interpolated as JavaScript. And so remember, everything, even what looks like, well, that's just a div, right? I'm actually kind of interacting with HTML. No. Somewhere there is a predefined React class that will output HTML for a div, but they're not the same thing. Even that div is JavaScript. So the life cycle, we kind of tried to talk about in terms of our elements, our comment box. Where does data go? From creation, we set our state and our properties. The first thing we do is the render method. Then we have custom methods that we'll show on our later examples to attach our handlers and do anything else that does require interacting directly with the newly created DOM. Then we get user input, the DOM events in the bottom right-hand corner. And what we're going to see with Flux is that we take an event handler, okay, to receive that action. Somebody pushed a button, what now? And we're going to dispatch an action, basically an event in the terms that most of us are used to. We dispatch that event, things are going to happen, and what's going to come back is that this element is now going to set state. It's now going to do an update, which triggers a re-render. This is just a really detailed version of the names of each of those lifecycle methods. The most critical ones are the three on the left. You're going to see these long lists of 8 or 10 lifecycle methods. Focus on the three on the left, component did mount. That's the same as in traditional HTML and JavaScript. We have to wait for our DOM to actually be ready, DOM ready. Okay, component will mount is basically DOM ready. Component did update is the same as DOM ready, but for only after a re-render, so that we can distinguish between that initial render and all the subsequent ones that follow. And then component will unmount is like in Angular on destroy. We tear down all of our event handlers and other library objects and things like that. Component will unmount does that for you in React. These others are advanced ones. We're going to skip right through those. So again, in our DOM, in our live application, your user is interacting with components. And the bottom line, the fundamental thing that they're doing that is mutating the state of the application, all of those things trigger calls to set state. And so let's say you change one piece of data that is reflected in 10 different places. Well, each of these little red arrows is going to be a set state that's firing on each of those components, making each of those components dirty in React terminology. So everything below those, everything below what's dirty, so the blue ones, is going to be re-rendered by default. So set state changes data, they turn dirty, they get re-rendered. You can hypothetically prevent that. What you can see down in the bottom right, we've walled off. Over here, that part is getting re-rendered. Over here, it's not. And that's because you can use this method called shouldComponentUpdate to sort of intercept what would normally update your application. This is an optimization, and it's not the kind of thing that you want to jump on right away. It's the kind of thing where you want to get your application up and running, not mess around with shouldComponentUpdate, and then go for that optimization when you can prove that it adds value with your profiler. And so the controller views, so we had this hierarchy of components. There's one that you'll see this name varies a lot. Some people call it the controller view. Some people call it the view controller. Some people call it the owner. Some people call it the stateful component because it's the one that owns the state. Whatever it is, it does mean that even though in React we say, oh no, all components are the same, everybody's just tiny atomic components, there are components that are more specialer than others. And these controller views are the ones that sit at the top of a branch of the tree and handle things like retrieving data and then updating all of the downstream elements. So the goal is to have as few of these things as possible and keep most of our components truly stateless. Just have them be as dumb as they could possibly be. And even these controller views, we don't want to overdo what data we put into them, but at the very least, whatever we do need to put in them will be encapsulated. Just a couple quick recipes with React. So conditional content, the equivalent of an ng-if. It's just JavaScript. So in this example, what you see down here, sorry, this text really isn't, let's blow it up as much as we can. What you see down here in this line is an interpolation. And what we're doing is we're just using the double ampersands, and we're saying, if this value is truthy, then render JSX stuff. If it's not, don't. That's it. It's as simple as that. You don't need any special API. You don't need any special tools. It's just JavaScript. And here's another way to do that. You can do it with a ternary operator. And you can say, if the window's logged in, show me the nav element. If the isLoggedIn value is not set, show me the login element instead. And if it's more complex than a ternary can handle, you can do it with a case statement. You simply set a value, content in this case, up at the top. You define whether content is the nav element, the login element, or the something else element, sorry, component. And then at the bottom, you simply say render whichever one of those I chose in my JavaScript. But you don't mix the logic to make that happen into components themselves, into the React API. It's just JavaScript. Similarly, we already saw how to do a collection. We simply take, we use a map. We map a component onto an array. And what we get back, in this case, items, we simply interpolate with curly brackets down at the bottom, items, an array of React components. That's it. It's just JavaScript. There's no magic there. There's no special API. And in fact, I think to a certain extent, React has to do some work to avoid imposing a new API on us. And I think they've done a nice job with that. And there's multiple formats for that. So React is very similar to other things you may know, to Ember components, to Angular directives, but it's the implementation that really varies. The good thing is that there's as little magic as is really possible. The magic is really just in the diffing algorithm and deciding how to render things. The important thing is that what React is saying to you is 95, 99% of the time, let us worry about how and when to render things. What you can do now is just think about this in terms of it'll just be re-rendered, and that's it. And you don't have to worry about statefulness in the DOM. You can focus on statefulness in JavaScript. Let React worry about statefulness in the DOM. There is a bit more typing, than a little more boilerplate than with certain other tools, certain other patterns, particularly once we get into Flux. But the tools for your browsers, for your text editor, for your IDE, for Sublime, eliminate the vast majority of that. And React ultimately is not a full application framework. We didn't see how to build a whole application with networking and services and all kinds of other stuff like that. All we saw was how to build components, just these little tiny interface widgets. So how do we get that? So we already did our stretching, a couple slides ahead of me. We build our whole application with something else, with the rest of the pattern. So the default, what most people start with React, and I'd recommend definitely your first application or two, try Flux on for size. A couple of people have asked me already about the other competitors for Flux, the third-party stuff. It's all good stuff. I would just say that for the sake of knowing where you are and what the pros and cons are, I'd recommend starting with Flux and then going on to Reflux or Redux or Alt or one of those others. So Flux is trying to improve on the MVC model, which even on a good day, you have a controller, but that controller is updating a million different models, and then once you update that model, there's a million view changes that cascade off of it. And they overlap and they cross over, and it's a pain. Flux is trying to fix that. It's not a framework. It's not even software. It's not even a library. It is really more of a pattern, more of an architecture, more of an idea that Facebook has really more specified than released. They've sort of shared it with us. This is how we do it. And they've given us a couple of the tools that they use. But most of the Flux pattern is just basic JavaScript, or in one case, kind of a node component. Most of it you create yourself, or you bring your tools from other places. Flux doesn't even include a router. That's how lightweight it is. You know, we wouldn't, the Ember and Angular teams wouldn't dream of not shipping their framework without a router. It's so fundamental, almost everybody wants one. But they're like, you can get, you know, other people make good routers, why should we? So let that be a separate, discrete concern. And use basic JavaScript wherever possible. Again, the further into Flux you get, the more crossover you see into the world of Node and NPM. And you see it's evolving. The alternate Flux library that was hot 6 months ago is all of a sudden no longer hot. That guy deprecated his library and said, go use this guy's library instead. It's evolving really, really quickly. I think that was Fluxer. I think Fluxer's been deprecated after being big for some time. Flux is basically just made up of these four basic ideas. Actions, dispatcher, stores, views. So the bottom one, the views, that's already our React components. Right? That's, we don't have to learn anything new about what are views in Flux. The dispatcher is just a dumb pipe for connecting together the other guys. So there's really not much you have to learn there. The interesting thing is the stores and the actions. So whereas before in a controller, in an MVC controller, sorry, I have to keep the scratchy throat going. In an MVC controller, you've got a lot of logic. You've got logic related to manipulating data, all merged together in one place, manipulating the view. The stores take that part of the controller function and separate them out. They're purely about storing and modifying and updating data. And then really, truly the glue that binds everything together, that allows you to move logic or move a flow throughout the application, is the actions. The actions are where you say, go do something that will have consequences throughout the application. There's also some use of an event pattern. But in general, when Facebook is trying to be really simple about it, they say, this is it, this is the whole thing. Action, dispatcher, store, view. It's a one-way data flow, a straight line, it's perfectly easy. Really, it's a little more complicated than that. But what you can see here, the big ones, action, dispatcher, store, view, are still intact. They're still the big concepts. What the other pieces are telling you is that there are things that, from a programming point of view, well, technically there's an event that was dispatched to get from the store to the view. And yes, events are an important concept. It's an important object to understand. But that's just what gets you through the same pattern, through the action, dispatcher, store, view cycle. But this is a really useful, I like this particular diagram better than the one before it for understanding what's really going on, what the little extra pieces of JavaScript are that bind this thing together. All right, and back to code already. We're going to make this thing. It is probably more complex than we should have tried to render today, but everybody else, every other demo you've ever seen anywhere, has done to-dos and chat applications absolutely to death. And the advantage of this one for me is that it's something I had done a while back in Angular, and I wanted to A, reuse all the styling and stuff, and B, just I had built React apps from scratch, but I had not taken something that I had previously done in Angular and torn it apart and rebuilt it in React just to see how it worked. So let's do that. Let's get rid of that guy, switch over here. This is our JavaScript. And there is our repository. Okay, we're going to start. This is, we were talking earlier about modules and stuff like that. I promised you more on that in just a second. This is more the whole traditional, the whole shebang, the way you see most React applications working. I like it. I think it works pretty well. But there's still a million opinions out there. You can do it the way it works for you. We're using a little bit of Gulp. Gulp is still fairly well known by most folks. Webpack seems to be bigger than Gulp, and certainly Grunt in the world of React. But it's by no means monolithic. It's not everywhere. The critical thing we're doing here, where before we were transforming our JSX in the browser, now we're doing it with this library called reactify. And so we just are setting up a watcher here, and that watcher is going to grab all of our JavaScript, find any JSX that's in the JavaScript, transform it, and then put it where we want it to be. And then the other thing that we're doing, so let's actually, let's start with index.html. Index.html, even simpler than it was before, we have exactly one script, and that script is starting with main. So before we said, you know, that you have very little HTML. Well, in this case, you know, because now we're compiling everything, you have very little JavaScript either. So everything starts from, with index. It's easier to move from left to right. We invoke main and we send it to container. So in main, what we're doing here is we're using the common JS pattern from Node. We have specified our npm dependencies here. We ran npm install to get browsify and gulp react object sign. And now we're just requiring the ones we need. And all we need for starters is there's a module called app, which contains a React component. And we're requiring React itself. And people look at this stuff and they go, oh, I have to type all of that. I have to import every single thing I ever use. And so A, once your constraints are really narrow, you don't have to do a lot of it. B, the tools make this really easy. So all I have to do to import React is that. It's, you know, three keystrokes with a fuzzy file matcher. And that's just an extension for simple one. And so what are we doing here? So we're invoking our root element and we're attaching it to the tiny minuscule little DOM that we already have in place. And we're simply saying render this basic app, and that's what you're seeing here. But what I have to do is I have to use the README, and I have to just start gulp. There we go. So we're using gulp to reactify our JSX, and then we're starting a very basic, because we didn't merge it into our automation, we're starting a very basic little node server called HTTPster. And now, there we go. We made everything so large. And I think it's 3. HTTPster is on 3333. Oh, I didn't cd to the correct directory. Sorry about that. Cd dist. Yeah, there we go. All right, and so that's it. That's our back end. Gulp, we've already heard about gulp. We use gulp to transpile our JSX, and then we inject our first component. Routing is something that we haven't seen done before. React in general has a very interesting way of handling routing. It's very declarative. Where in Angular, for instance, you go off into this other file somewhere, and you declare a bunch of routes and the configurations of those routes. Here, we actually do it inside our root-level component. We import these tools called routes, the React router component, and then its subcomponents, locations, and location. And what we do then is say, all right, here's a bunch of locations. For each location, here's the path that it corresponds to, and then here's the handler. And that handler is nothing more than a React component. The component called login, which goes on the login path. Component called ideas on the ideas path. That's it. This thing here called superstructure is nothing other than sort of the outer, the chrome, if you will, of the page, the header, the footer, stuff like that. And what we're doing then is delegating, this.props.children is delegating to the stuff that's coming through from the routing. And again, this.props.children is a basic React concept. It's not API for the router. It's just stuff. It's just JavaScript. And so once we have that, we now have a login route, we have an ideas route, and we can hop back and forth between them. For what it's worth, I'm using here a router called the React router component. It is slightly simpler. I thought it would make a better demo, but the seemingly undisputed hands-down champion that most people, that seems to get most of the love, is just called React router. It is sort of the React equivalent of the Angular UI router. All right, and we can start doing, one of the things that you have to configure on your router is how to handle bad routes. We haven't done that. Okay, so here we go. We've actually got some stuff now to look at, to interact with. We actually have a form. So the question is, how have we implemented that form? So we look in our components. So this is an important thing about React in general. We organize everything. You were asking before about separation of concerns. Often we've got a folder for JavaScript, a folder for HTML, a folder for CSS. In React land, you almost always organize things by the component. And so if you did have, same as with the gulp, generator gulp Angular workflow, you know, you have a component-driven thing, but you have a lot more files in each component. Here, you generally just have your JavaScript. And in this case, you can mingle some concerns together. So in the login workflow, we've got multiple things that are part of login, and so we can just put them in one folder or we can put them in separate folders. But each one is a component. Each one of these is a component that we're exporting. See this line down here at the bottom? Okay. This is how we make it basically into a common JS module and make it available to be imported using the require pattern up here at the top. So every component is executed that way. Yes, hand. Yeah, there's kind of nothing special about that. That is something where you're going to be working with the API provided to you by your router of choice. It's all there. I'd recommend just checking out the React router documentation and the examples of how to use it. Notably, the other thing that I think goes, two questions people always want to know. How do I do conditional routing for things like login? And how do I do async data loading so that I get data? So like with the Angular route.resolve, how do I get my data into my view before I render it? React router has a way of doing both of those things. I'm sorry, speak up. Oh, yes, exactly. That's what we're about to do. So we're not doing any ideas yet. We're still working on the login page. So here's the login component. Basic HTML, some divs, and note that whatever you return from your render function needs to be just one element. So if you have a bunch of siblings, you have to wrap them. It's just something you'll run into in the compiler. So we have basic divs here, and then we have this thing called login tabs. Login tabs allows us to show off the fact that we already have a bootstrap implementation for React, and it's really quite mature. So we're taking advantage of the tab pane from Bootstrap, and so that allows us to jump back and forth between these tabs. And you import it just like you do anything else. You import the component, and then you make use of it here in your render function. And note these props here, event key. Okay, we're just declaring those as attributes inside of this tab pane. Event key is going to be this.props.eventKey. And that, I think, is everything we've got here, except that we also have the signup form element. So this signup form, this is where we're starting to see a more complex element. Part of the reason for this, sorry about this, I ran a prettifier on this. Anybody who uses, I have a prettifier set up in my JavaScript so that rather than manually re-indenting everything, I just hit a key and it boom, it does it all for me and takes care of the white space. Your standard JavaScript prettifiers will mangle the heck out of your JSX because they don't recognize it. And that's what happened here. I apologize for this. So there's an add-on for Sublime, or it's actually, I think, just a setting for Babel that prevents that from happening. But as you're getting into React, you'll need to make these, you know, tooling adjustments so that you can not experience pain from this. But there's nothing terribly fancy about this form here. It's a standard form. We're using basic HTML form elements, div h4 p, a regular plain old input. What's happening though? Well, we've got our first event handlers. In React, you declare your event handlers in line on the HTML. This is kind of like how Angular does directives. We mingle a little bit of JavaScript back into our HTML. And it also makes sense. It's not really a separation of concerns the way it used to be, because again, the whole thing, the whole component is encapsulated right here. So when I declare this onSubmit handler, okay, and I say onSubmit, on the submit event that is a React specific event, fire this function, this.onFormSubmit, and boom, there it is right there, five lines away. So everything is tightly bound, is right together, all in one place, rather than having to go track three files from here what's happening. The one other thing that's happening here, that's going to be our submit, and then on each of these inputs, okay, so we've got two inputs for the name and the email address, we have an onChange handler. Okay, so this is where traditionally in Angular, for instance, we would set up two-way data binding. We would do ng-model or something like that, right? And boom, ng-model, it's taken care of. Here we have three or four more lines of code to write than that. What we're going to do is just on the change of each of these, we're just going to do set state. Okay, that's what updates everything for our whole component hierarchy with the value that's coming from the target element. That's it. That gets us our binding of the value in that input to our representation of the state of the data for our component. And I think that's it for this phase, login tabs, sign up form. Yep. So let's do something useful with that. This is where we get to our actions. This is where we really start to break out of the world of just React, and we start moving through the data flow around the whole application. The first thing that we're going to do, yes. On the form, on submit, yep. I have a what? Yes, an action, and we're about to see the action. With the action? Yeah, we're about to see the action. You're preempting. So we just set up our field. The great thing about this actually is that we can move step by step. We can figure out how to obtain our data, put it onto the state, do that first, and then move through the cycle of Flux. So what we're going to do now, sometimes it's quicker just to jump in here. We're going to create our actions. So those are here in their own folder. Here's a file called actions. And we've created an action called sign up new user. And what you should find in the sign up form is that on submit, and now we have more methods here, on form submit, we're calling actions.signupNewUser. And again, we're injecting everything using common JS modules. So we declare var actions equals the module that stores our actions. and then we can reference the methods that are exposed by that module. So in the in that cycle we looked at, they drew a distinction between something called an action and something called an action creator. So to the extent that there is a distinction, the whole thing we think of together as, you know, actions. By the action creator, what they mean is a function that creates an action object and does whatever else needs to happen. So in this case, what we're doing is we're calling our API. We've created an additional module called API utilities. And in this, we're just emulating, we're mocking a server call. And so in this action, we're saying, all right, my user wants to register himself. He's provided me with an email and a password. Please go to the server and check and find out if this is valid. If so, register him and let me know what the response is. And that returns a promise. Validate new user returns a promise. So promise.then, and this is where we actually dispatch the action. Depends on who you ask, but this little object here, technically a lot of folks refer to seemingly as the action object, and that's why this function is the action creator, to the extent that there's a difference there. So we've started with the view. The view has triggered an action. The action is now invoking the dispatcher. The dispatcher is this guy here. Very simple, very basic code. The dispatcher, this dispatcher is a library that Facebook released. It's the only part of the Flux pattern that is actually code, that's actually a library. So we just create a new dispatcher object. And we let's see here. Basically, whenever the dispatcher is a dumb pipe, whatever we pipe into it, it's going to push back out to whoever's listening. And so in this case, we're going to dispatch a view action, and we're going to pass along this payload here, this type and these credentials. And so anyone who is listening, can receive the response. So I don't know if we did that yet in this commit. I don't think we have. So what we've done is we've created the action, we've sent it to the dispatcher, and what we can do in the next step, we want to do something with that, right? We want to tell the parts of the application that something has happened, that need to know, and then close the loop, bring it back. So what happens after the dispatcher receives this view action? It sends it to the store. Whoops, misspelling. In this case, we're using the user store. Stores, ideally, we divide up based on your entity types or perhaps a domain of the application if you don't have something that's that clear and object-oriented as an entity type. But you'll have several of them, and they should separate your concerns. Your users should be in one of them. Your ideas should be in another. And in the store, we're registering with the dispatcher. Okay? We started in our view. We created an action. We used the dispatcher to relay that action to anyone who wants to hear about it. And what we do is we receive all of the actions that come in, and then we do a switch. We say, all right, well, what kind of action was it? And the action was new user registered. Okay, so it starts in an action, it goes through the dispatcher, and the store is listening for events called new user registered, and then what it will do is we're just logging it, okay, I received this event, and then we're saying establish a user using the credentials that came in on the action. Now note, we've jumped through some hoops to get here, but the store doesn't have to know anything about what's actually going on. All it knows is data shows up, I do what I'm told with it, and then I send out a notification that something changed. And that means that your store itself, like our React components, is very discrete, very narrow, very focused just on doing what it does best, which is update data and then tell people it updated data. And what we're doing in this case, we're going to see a more typical example later of just emitting a change event. In this case, though, we're not really changing, we're not mutating the state of anything after the user signs up. What we're doing is just telling the view component that it was successful. And the view component, which is all the way back on sign up form, is going to receive this event called sign up success. And in response to a sign up success, we're going to navigate. Now, something, here's where the React ecosystem gets a little bit, sometimes you wish there was a little more magic. Sometimes you wish things were a little more abstracted from you. What we wind up having to do in our application is grab an instance of the, in component did mount, we are capturing a reference to the router. This, in full frameworks, this kind of thing happens by default. You just know that there's some service out there called location and that you can grab that service and do useful things with it. In this case, you have to set that up yourself. You have to capture it. You have to store it. And then you can reference it later and actually do useful things with it. So what we have done is now we can type in a user and a name and hit create. And let's see, did we actually jump ahead? I think there may be one actual thing that just needs to, that gets finished here. So let's do that again. Create. Maybe we have a compile problem. Yep, there we go. So this is part of life with React, and in particular with compiling your JSX, is that periodically you'll error out. Now, usually this is very useful. This gives JavaScript people a compiler to catch our bugs for us, to catch our syntax errors. This is actually very useful most of the time. At the moment, all it's doing is throwing an exception on the fact that something changed quicker than it really expected. So we reload it. Whoops. Now there is something. Unhandled error event, can't find module. Login at. Oh, did I add that as a can't find actions from login. I think that this is one of the rough edges that we sometimes run into. Because this code normally works beautifully. And at least this part of it does. There's lots of other parts that are totally screwed up. What's that? A reset of what? There isn't anything. There are no changes. So let's dump that. Let's create a new tab real quick. IFF. And let's try gulp again. That's a good one. Well, we'll demo in just a second after we move on to another another commit. But basically what we're doing is we're continuing on through the cycle. We have successfully logged in. It took us a lot of work to log in. We have figured out how to pass things through the cycle. We start from here on the login form. We create an action. We send the action to the dispatcher. The dispatcher sends it to the store. The store says, okay, I've recorded this. I've captured it so that you can use it and reference it later. And then all the store does at that point is it says, I did it. I did what you asked me to. Anyone in the entire application, whether it's five components or just one, who wants to know when changes happen, here you go, a change happened. It's as simple as that. And then we listen for those changes. So the new thing we need to do once we've done that is actually render the idea store. So let's jump forward a commit. And we're going to create a... we're going to start separating our actions into view actions and API actions, just for clarity's sake. And then... And then in the idea store, we can start dealing with them. So when the user renders ideas, we load up our ideas component. Got it. Often, one of the things we want to do is we want to load certain data when the application bootstraps, because it's an app-wide concern rather than a component-specific concern. So what we're doing is in our main JS file, we're calling our API utilities, receiving all of the ideas. Now, normally, what we're doing then is kind of waiting around, like, okay, I have to wait for those ideas so that I can do something with them. In this case, there is no then, there is no what happens next. Our goal is that we want to fire events like this and forget about them. You don't launch some rockets on the battlefield and tie a string to it and stand there with the string tied to your finger waiting for the rocket to land so you know what happened. You just launch a bunch of them and you wait for the boom. The event that comes back later is the boom, but you don't sit there and hold on to it whenever humanly possible. And so what's happening is that the idea store, so before we set up some listeners in the user store, now the idea store is waiting for, this event called add all ideas. So whenever those ideas get done being retrieved, the idea store will be there, it'll receive this event, and it can stash them away. So that when we move on and begin actually building out our ideas component, that we can get it done. And so there's our ideas component. It's starting to come together now. Okay, so we this is all just basic boilerplate. And so if we log in now, let's see if we can get our gulp. Yeah, gulp is fine. So if we log in, there's our ideas component. It's there, it loads, and for some reason it doesn't like it. Let's, we are serving on 3333. Let's open a new window just in case. These are some of the rough edges that you sand off once you get your router working properly. There we go. So it's navigating successfully. We're seeing our ideas view, but we need some stuff to put into it. So let's render that list. Here in the ideas component, we are executing the idea list, okay? The idea list is what actually contains the data. And in this case, we have delegated down to, let's close some windows here. Don't save anything, thank you. We want to open the idea list. And we have delegated to the idea list the job of getting state from the idea store. We don't want the idea store to tell us when it feels like giving us state. That would be a hard dependency. That would be coupling everything. Instead, we ask for it when we want it. And in this case, we tell the idea store, inform me when there's a change. Don't tell me what to do with that change. Don't tell me I got this data so that you could do a certain thing. Just tell me any time it changed. And so what we're doing is that at the very beginning of the life cycle of this component, we go and get the ideas from the idea store, and anytime the store tells us that something changed, this is optional. Some people will pass a payload on the event, but hypothetically, you're totally decoupled when all you get on the event is something changed, request updates, okay? And then we reuse this function to get the data and to populate it. And so all we've got is we're taking this.state.ideas, we're mapping it onto this new component called idealist_items, and then we're rendering it out by this interpolation right here. And we have to refresh, log in. And if I actually have data here yet, yes, we have ideas. And so our data now is moving throughout the cycle. We've got multiple flux cycles going. We've got one going for users. We've got one going for ideas as well. We want to we want to have a modal so that we can actually interact with these ideas. We want to be able to click on this, and this is one of the downsides of how this is structured. Normally there's conditional logic here to let you back in if you're logged in. We want to be able to open these up and see what's going on with them. Yeah, this is strange. I'm getting all kinds of compiler errors today. And so what we're going to do is, in the idea list, in each, we render our ideas. And then each idea list item, we not only have the content, this content here is what you're seeing in the view, but then we have this modal that we're going to launch. And this is a React bootstrap modal. So we invoke this modal up here, we inject it, okay, no globals. We're just pulling this modal straight in. We create, that's a little premature, and then here's the structure for the modal, which is going to show when the state says that we should be allowed to show it. Now that's kind of messy. We've just taken all this modal junk and we've polluted our idealist item with that. So even better, if we refactor the idea modal into a separate component, so that now all we have to do is just invoke this idea modal here, and the modal is a totally separate standalone component which can manage its own state. And so hypothetically, yes, compile works, refresh. And we can click on one of these and see the detail of this idea. And what we're going to do then is we want to be able to do additional things with these ideas. The point of this application, sorry I didn't explain that sooner, this is for a kind of a team building, let's improve our organization day. So you can create ideas, you can join an idea so that you can be part of the team. That's why you see the team count over here, the participants. And we want to be able to join ideas and leave the ideas. So what do you need in order to make that happen? To select an idea, we're going to dispatch a bunch of events. There's a new event called User Joins Idea. And we need a button. And that's basically it. We're going to create a button that allows the user to join the idea. When we click on that button, we're going to dispatch an action. The action goes to the store. The store captures the fact that that user is now associated to that idea and then informs us that there's something new. And we want to then subscribe to that action in the idea Well, we're creating a new component, actually, the user-created idea. And in the user-created idea, we're asking for, we're checking the state. We're subscribing to the user store, and we're checking what is the selected idea. And so if we're still compiling, we are. If we refresh, log in, that's fine. We can now join this idea, which will dispatch an action, which goes to the store. The store simply tells us there's something new. We request, what is it that's new? Aha, we have an idea selected now, and it'll render. And again, it renders. This component is doing some very, very simple conditional logic here, where it says, if idea, meaning the idea the user has selected, is undefined, well, if it's undefined, give me nothing. Give me an empty div. But if it is now defined, then render all of this other content here. And then leaving or editing the idea is... and creating a new idea are simply expansions of those concepts. We're just layering on more events, more actions. We can join the idea. We can... we should... My apologies. I'm really getting some strange behavior after running through this many, many times. And this is some of the things that I find still a little bit uncomfortable about this ecosystem. There we go. We get some inexplicable errors that I don't see in other tools. So we can leave this idea, which means dispatch an idea again, which just says the user left the idea. Sorry, dispatch an action. The store deletes the selected idea, informs the view, hey, by the way, there are changes. The view requests, what are the changes? Oh, there's no more selected idea. And so the idea goes away. But nothing, nobody in the whole chain of events knows how anybody else is consuming those actions, that information. All they know is that it's happening, and they have instructions about how to deal with what is happening. The last thing we can do is we can edit. And in this component, in the selected idea component, we have multiple versions of, there's a new modal. And this is why I said that this app is about 50% more complex than it should be. We have an editable area. And we swap that editable area, editable details here, with the static details. And again, simple JavaScript, is this.state.editing, is that true? Is it truthy? If it is, show me the editable content. If it's not, show me the regular content. There's no magic there. There's no API there. But there are individual little components that can handle each of the details. And just like before, when we update what's in a form, we capture the value, we send it to the store. The store tells us there's an update, and then we request, well, what is that update? So there's a whole round trip that happened between pressing save changes and having it be re-rendered into the view. In a controller-based and an MVC-based model, the controller would immediately assign what you just did straight onto the view. In React, we send it to the store. The store tells us that there's a change, and then we simply re-render. We don't have to worry about keeping all of those things in sync, dealing with that view-based asynchronousness. And that... Yes. Yes, if we import it. So the question is the store visible to all the components? And so we are taking advantage of the store here, for instance, in the idea modal. And so we just have to request it. We're importing it. It's a common JS module. We simply import that module, and now I can reference it from within my methods, from within my render if I needed to. So where Angular gives us this sort of implicit dependency injection, it says, no, don't worry about modules. We got modules. We'll take care of it for you. Just give your service a name. Just give your controller a name, and we'll worry about the rest. The common JS pattern allows us or requires us to import each one individually, inject them into our component. And what this means is that there is nothing going on in this component that I can't see up here at the top. There is no other magic. There's nothing hidden. There's nothing else going on except I have a reference to the React library and to these two individual stores. So let's get out of here. So actions are our discrete atomic bits of logic. If something happens, do these other three things. They're as close as it gets to the controller, the action-based part of the controller. The stores will sometimes have data manipulation logic that would also be in a controller. We want to fire and forget. We don't want to be hanging on to that rocket after we launch it. We want to just send it, listen for the boom, and then do something based on hearing the boom. Its actions are often, but not exclusively, where our API calls are triggered, and then we just tell everyone the outcome. Yes? Debugging what in particular? Yep. 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 Well, there is still a stack. There just isn't. There aren't internal dependencies written into that stack. There aren't assumptions. But the call stack is still there. The call stack works the same way. You're gonna see that the initial view fired a bunch of methods that created an action. Then that you're gonna see a bunch of methods fire on the dispatcher. Then after the dispatcher, you're going to see a bunch of methods fire on the store. Then after the store, you're going to see it emit an event, and you're going to see your view components receive that event. So it's all still there in the stack. It's just that you haven't written it into this thing. Instead of thinking, you know, having this monolithic controller, because we think it's easier if we cram hundreds of lines of code into one place, we think it'll somehow be easier to debug. Instead, what we can say is, all I need to know is that events will come. You log those events as they come in, and then you say, okay, I'm getting the event now, and now I'll react to that event. From JS to JSX, the debugging, I mean, you can, it's like anything, if anybody uses coffee, I don't like coffee, but you know, you can just open up the compiled, well, for starters, as you could see from these many errors that we were getting, the JSX compiler will catch many, so your runtime errors, if you have any question about what those are, what the JSX compiler is translating is not generally a source of complexity. You're simply changing, almost exclusively what the compiler is doing is saying, there's this component called login items, invoke it, and take these things I declared as attributes on my XML element and add them as payload, and it's very good at doing that. I have yet to see a situation where there was a bug that was occurring in transpilation Usually it's the consumer. It's the code that you write that takes advantage of those attributes and makes use of them. But what you can always do is you can go into your dist file, and you can open up this JS, and you know, let's say we're looking for the user selected idea. So I can just look for a user selected idea, and all of that code is here in its transpiled form. And so you can see here, instead of a bunch of XML elements, here is react.createElement, and same stuff, just in a slightly less readable format. But it's a very linear algorithm. That transpilation is not, there's not much complexity there. Yes. Well, but again, generally, I haven't at least run into situations where I really, unless something is surprising me, I don't generally need to get into this. Generally, I can just look at what's going on in the original version that has the JSX and find the obvious errors there. I think that a lot of this goes to the general automation workflow, to the use of grunt and gulp in general, and to any transpilation that we're doing, whether it's ES6 to ES5 or JSX to JSX to React Elements. In general, the concerns are so narrow, so simple, so well-defined that the things that we imagine we're going to wind up needing to track down in transpiled code aren't opaque. They aren't things that are hidden in the transpilation. They're things that we can debug in the pre-transpiled code, in the original source. But that's dealing with an automation workflow, and transpilation is a whole session by itself. So the actions... this one thing that we didn't point out explicitly is that we often use these things called action constants. And the reason is that when you're passing events around and action names, it is so easy to misspell the name of an action or event. By creating a constant like this and always referring to it as a property name, so here I'm dispatching it, and I'm dispatching it by reference to constants.newUserRegistered, I pretty much guarantee I'm not going to misspell it. If I misspell it, I'm going to get a type error rather than something that fails silently because it's passing an event throughout the ecosystem that has the wrong name on it, and I wind up not getting the behavior I expected. So that's just a best practice. The dispatcher is, there's only one per app. It's dumb. The only clever trick it has is something called wait for, and that's where you have two stores that are kind of sharing data. So there's a great example. Facebook provides a tutorial that's a chat application. Chats are often threaded, okay? So how do you represent that? So in their case, they created one store for the threads. You create an object for a thread, and then that thread has references to the actual messages. The messages live over in this other store. So anytime you update either a message or a thread, you need to make sure that the updates have happened in both places before you begin to render. Wait for simply allows you to specify the priority. And it's on an action by action basis. So our stores, about one per domain. We can use it for things like modeling relationships. All it does is take in changes, do the data processing logic. Let's say you're getting JSON and you want to rehydrate those objects into real JavaScript objects, augment them with new properties, new methods, something like that. Do that in your store. Stores are smart about data and then dumb about everything else. They have no idea what's going on in the interface. Note that unlike many frameworks, Flux has no opinions about models. It likes plain old JavaScript objects perfectly well. And consider working with immutable data structures. The whole concept of your React components re-rendering rather than being mutated or updated is related to this idea about immutability. If you're messing with something, if you're injecting new things or pulling out one piece and sticking in another, you've got all this potential for error, for making mistakes. So that's why with React, we simply re-render the component from scratch rather than try to tweak it. Immutable data structures basically apply the same principle to your arrays of data. And there is a recipe, there is a mix-in for two-way data bindings. It's actually a very simple concept. It's not hard to implement yourself, but if you want to save four lines of code, the mix-in will do it for you. So we get powerful patterns here. It's not a framework, but it is a really powerful pattern that makes it hard to mingle our concerns. It makes it hard to have interdependencies. We create our action, we send it off. We receive the action, we do something with it, we send off the result. We receive the result, we do something with that. At each point, there's no ties binding us, and we're able to iterate on this piece, on this store, on this component, without affecting everything else. As long as you conform to your API and pass events, and these are universal events, everything still works. The one, I think, concern that I still don't have a definitive impression on, or my early impression over the last few months, is you'll spend more time up front creating a lot of things than you would have with something like Angular or Ember. Over the long term, though, the maintenance of those things gets dramatically easier. So there's a crossover point where the additional upfront investment and the decreased downstream maintenance overlap. I think that comes in fairly quickly, like something that you're going to be dealing with for more than even just a few weeks. I think you get your return on investment for this pattern. But I probably am not going to use it for rapid prototyping, something that's only going to stick around for a week or two. For the time being, I can still move a lot faster in Angular, and Angular saves you time in ways that become problematic down the road, but that work great in the short term. There's a lot of freedom. We work with enterprises a lot. Enterprises don't like developer freedom a lot. We keep trying to persuade them to give their developers more freedom. What we're trying to figure out right now about React is this environment structured enough that we can hand this over to our clients and have them be comfortable that their teams are going to be able to handle it? And I don't think we have a final answer to that yet. We've done it successfully a few times. But it really depends on the client. It depends on the environment. HTML templating is going to stay around for a while, but I don't know, at least in React land, it doesn't have to, and I don't know how long. And it's what I don't think anybody is certain about is whether Facebook is going to really be sort of the granddaddy of React and specifically of Flux, the way that Angular or Google is with Angular, and if that's even needed. Right? Do we need someone to steer? Do we need someone to make sure that movement drives forward? The early indications are that the community is willing to pick up the pieces and create all of these other tools, Redux, Reflux, Alt. The trick is just getting them to be as well documented and as well supported as they would be if they were all coming from the mothership. So that's something that is going to evolve over time. And the best loved components will eventually be better documented and better supported. This whole idea of virtual DOM, I think, is oversold in some ways, at least in terms of your life and what React and Flux mean to you. An HTML document, if you model the whole application in HTML, it's a virtual DOM. It is a serialized DOM. So that's not the magic. I think what's far more interesting is the fact that we've decoupled the DOM and the logic, and that it's immutable, that we simply replace it. Something changed, just replace the whole thing. Don't worry about mutating it. Don't worry about dealing with it. I think that idea is more powerful than what we often hear about in the articles that say, "Wow, virtual DOM makes everything a million times faster than it used to be. Woo!" this stuff is what really changes our life, is that everything is clearer and easier to think about and simpler to update. And the performance issue, I'll let you guys read this offline, is qualified. There are certain things that React clearly does exceptionally well, but so many of these examples are about rendering 1,500 rows of something. Why are you rendering 1,500 rows of something? Your user can't see 1,500 rows. So being a library that makes it easy to render 1,500 rows quickly is not necessarily a big advantage. And this is just a guy who wrote a really good article about how sometimes plain old JavaScript will beat even React for rendering 1,500 rows. You can see actually React is getting significantly slower over time on mobile. And it's those diffing algorithms that are doing it. So the pattern's more important than the hype. I wouldn't say that the number one reason to adopt React is speed, although certainly the speed is strong, it's there, it's good, but it's about the patterns. And if you want to, the good thing about, a lot of people are pushing the idea, oh, well, you can gradually migrate to React just where it helps you with speed. Yeah, you can gradually migrate to React. You can blend in a React component here or there. But I think the reason to do it is because you want to learn the pattern. These are extras. Those will be in the slides, which will be posted online. And it is exactly 3:30. It's time to go. I see the thumb. Yeah. Thank you all very much. I'm going to stick around. Anything else that you want to talk about that we didn't get to, my apologies. But that's why they're in the extras slides. We can talk about offline. Oh, yeah, well, do we have, if we have time, yeah.
Yeah, maybe 5 minutes.
Okay, questions? Yes, the slides, you mean? The code is in GitHub. One of the first slides actually showed that both of the repositories are already in GitHub and are available. The first repo is actually just copies, basically, of other people's demos, but with lots of comments. That's really the only value add there, is all the comments. The second one, though, is more original and is available. Stores, are singletons, you mean, are they regenerated over and over again? Yeah, they're long-lived singletons. They're kind of like, if you think of the Angular service pattern, the premise there is that services are long-lived singletons, and stores are long-lived singletons.
Asking for ideas store, so it is reading the idea store file, but then it doesn't have data, which one component has but the other component doesn't. So how would you share data between two components which are sitting in two different routes?
I think that goes to implementation, and I don't have a good short-term implementation answer. But they are singletons. They do persist.
I've been using Angular. I'm not yet used React, but it seems like there are like some good bits in Angular.
Yep.
There are good bits in the way that React has been implemented. So like, would it be best to say, okay, mix and match, like take the view component from React, which is very like composable and things like that, and use the best of Angular, which is like routing, dependency injection, all that stuff, like use the best of both worlds.
I think if Brad Green were here, he'd say check out Angular 2.0. There is a lot of similarity to that idea of what's best about Angular plus the componentization that React gives you and decoupling and fewer leaky abstractions. That's the premise behind what Angular 2.0 is going to be. But it's not here yet. We can't really see it in its finished form yet in compare and contrast. I think that they certainly React itself as atomic view components is very easy to mix into other patterns. Flux, the broader Flux pattern is, I think, a stronger overall pattern than the current Angular 1.x pattern. And so ideally, I would pick one or the other there. So you can do it, but the long-term answer is it's not, the race isn't over. This is a marathon, and Angular 2 is coming. Other things are coming. Aurelia is coming. All that Aurelia is much more template-based for starters. And we'll see.
All right. So I think that's all we have for the workshop. Thanks a lot, Christian.